Hey folks, this is Riker with a Diablo 3 patch 2.6.1 Season 12 guide on the Jade Harvester Witch Doctor. While we're still in the beta phase for the coming patch, the Jade Harvester set got a huge buff, and this build, an old favorite of mine, is coming back in a big way, looking to be one of the top builds. As of right now, we've seen it clear as high as a Greater Rift 110 on the leaderboards. As we dive into showing the gameplay, I'm just going to quickly note that if you'd like to get your name on the Rikers Raiders 2017 t-shirt, you have until the end of September. Link in the description below on how to do that. So let's start with a gear overview. You'll need the full 6 pieces of the Jade Harvester set. The 2-piece bonus is pretty negligible, but the 4-piece bonus gives Soul Harvest the effect of every rune, and its cooldown is reduced by 1 second every time you cast Haunt or Locust Swarm. Haunt is the one that uses less mana, so that's the one we're really going to be spamming in order to reduce this cooldown. Then for the 6-piece bonus, this is where the big buff happened for this set, both in damage and it got a toughness buff. Now when you cast Soul Harvest, you gain 50% damage reduction for 12 seconds. You'll want to maintain this buff at all times. And this bonus also makes it so that when you pop Soul Harvest, your damage over time effects that you've applied to enemies, which we'll go over in a bit, deal all of their damage instantly. This is a really cool mechanic that makes this one of the most interesting sets in the game. It results in really fun playstyle, and it's also a really robust build. While it's not necessarily brainless to play, it's not super difficult, and it has really, really, really great survivability. Now, before we go over any other items, we're gonna quickly jump to the skills so that we can better understand what's gonna be going on here. And it all revolves around Haunt and Locust Swarm. Haunt is a skill that deals a bunch of damage to an enemy over 12 seconds. With the 6-piece of Jade, you can make all that damage happen instantly. Locust Swarm costs a lot more mana and deals a lot less damage, but that damage spreads more easily to other enemies. And if that enemy dies while under the effect of Haunt, that Haunt will jump to another enemy. Now, Locust Swarm is a power that costs a lot more mana and deals a lot less damage, but it spreads more easily and to more enemies. So these are the two damage over time effects that we're using with this build that the 6-piece bonus will trigger when we pop Soul Harvest. So let's get back to the items now. The Haunting Girdle is going to be a really good belt to use because it allows Haunt to release an additional spirit. That's 2 Haunts for the price of 1. This could be a really mana thirsty build, so this really helps. Means we don't have to spam it as much, and the spam is going to be more about just reducing the cooldown on Soul Harvest rather than needing to cast it on every single enemy around you. Lakumba's Ornament are really good bracers that give us some great survivability. For every stack of Soul Harvest we have, we gain more damage reduction. We're going to want to maintain our full stacks of Soul Harvest at all times. Now, typically that's 5. You can only have 5 stacks of Soul Harvest unless you have the Sacred Harvester, which is, again, a mandatory item for this build. This brings us up to 10 stacks, so that's 60% damage reduction with your Lakumbas. Now, another mandatory item here is the Ring of Emptiness. This is a ring that lets you deal quadruple damage, that's 300 times more damage, to enemies affected by both Haunt and Locust Swarm, and it's going to be very important that any enemy that you try to deal damage to, you're going to ensure that they have both Haunt and Locust Swarm on them. This is a build about setting up dominoes before knocking them over. So you're going to want to make sure you got your Haunt on them, you're going to want to make sure you got your Locust Swarm on them, and only then can you pop your Soul Harvest. Another very important item for this build is the Quetzalcoatl Spirit Mask. This makes Haunt and Locust Swarm deal their damage in half the normal duration. What this means is double damage. And then for our weapon, just because we don't really have a better option, we're going with a Furnace that is more damage versus elites. For your offhand, you have some choices here. You could go with Henry's Perquisition. This gives you some nice toughness, but if you feel you don't need it, you can go with a Vile Hive. This lets you squeeze out a bit more damage. Do note though that the brunt of your damage is coming from Haunt, not Locust Swarm. That said, it still does add some amount of damage. How much exactly is still being worked out. A Convention of Elements works really well in this build. I know it's not everyone's favorite playstyle to have to wait for a rotation, and if you really don't care for that, you could largely ignore that, but if you really want to optimize your play, you're going to want to attempt to pop your Soul Harvest, particularly once you're inside your poison window. We're going to be opting for poison runes. If you go for a different rune combination, just make sure you're going with whatever element that is. This becomes more important versus Rift Guardians, I find, but you can generally, if you're fast enough, you can get in an additional attack before your next poison rotation comes in. But just because this is a build that is not dealing continuous damage, it's a build in which you kind of have to wait a few seconds, not too long, it's not a huge cooldown build like Tragul's Corpse Lance on the Necromancer. So it's just a few seconds between your Soul Harvest, between your damage dealing. You could better time this with a convention. And then we're rounding this out with a Traveler's Pledge and a Compass Rose for more damage and more toughness. For our gems, we're gonna want a Bane of the Trapped that's gonna be more damage at all times. This is a build in which you're getting in the face of enemies and dealing damage to enemies right around you, so they're gonna be inside that Bane of the Trapped area. Bane of the Stricken, really useful for Greater Rift pushing. For faster runs, you can opt for a Bane of the Powerful. And Esoteric Alteration gives you a bit more survivability. Again, this build is really tough. Alright, let's head back for a closer look at the skills. Obviously, we need to take Haunt, which typically is a cold skill. We're going with Poison Spirit. This makes it a poison build. This makes haunted enemies take 20% more damage from your attacks. Now, if you want, you could go with Resentful Spirits instead. Make it a cold build. This will let you release two spirits with every cast. So if you feel you're having trouble getting those spirits out on all the enemies that you need to, you might want to opt for this. You can see which works for you. Then with Locust Swarm, we're going with the Pestilence Rune because that gives Locust Swarm a 100% guarantee to jump to two additional enemies instead of one. Again, Locust Swarm costs 300 mana, 300 to Haunt's 50. We want to be casting Locust Swarm as seldomly as possible. Now, if you got a Vile Hive, you get Pestilence for free. That's probably the best thing about the Vile Hive. In which case, Cloud of Insects is generally a good choice. This gives you some damage reduction. Now, you could be wondering, but Cloud of Insects is physical damage. We're not specking for physical. Well, again, Haunt is going to be dealing the brunt of our damage here. We're really just working in Locust Swarm because of that synergy with the Ring of Emptiness. So it doesn't really matter that we're not optimizing for Locust Swarm damage. Looking at our other skills, we obviously are taking Soul Harvest and we're getting every rune on that. Now you want to maintain the full 10 stacks of Soul Harvest. For every enemy that you consume in Soul Harvest, you gain another stack up to a max of 10. And once you have 10 stacks, all you have to do is refresh on one enemy and you're going to maintain those 10 stacks. This is another quality of life change, I believe, in this coming patch, and it is a great change for this build. At its base, Soul Harvest is giving you more intelligence. That means more damage and a bit more toughness. The rune you take doesn't matter because you're getting all runes for free. Every time you pop Soul Harvest with Swallow Your Soul, you're drinking a mana potion, and your maximum mana is also increased. Siphon also makes it a health potion. Language gives you more toughness while nerfing enemies' speed. Soul to Waste makes you move faster for a bit after casting it. And Vengeful Spirit basically does nothing. Now for a mobility power, Spirit Walk. You can either go with the Jaunt rune or Severance. Jaunt makes Spirit Walk last longer, whereas Severance lets you move faster. They're about equally good. It's your choice which you want to opt for. We're also going with Horrify, Frightening Aspect. This gives us a nice toughness buff. And then we're taking Piranha's Pyrenado simply to group up enemies. It's excellent crowd control. As for our passives, Spirit Vessel gives you a free life. Confidence Ritual makes us deal more damage to enemies within 20 yards, which is going to be the enemies that we're hitting. That's the range of our Soul Harvest. More or less. Creeping Death gives us a huge damage buff with this build because it makes Haunt and Locust Swarm last almost forever. And you also don't have to worry about the damage buff given from piranhas ever dropping off. Once you've piranhaed an enemy once, they're going to be taking that 15% increased damage forever. Then lastly, we have Grave Injustice. Every time an enemy dies within 20 yards, which can be extended by plus health globe pickup radius, you regain 1% of your max life and mana, and you reduce the cooldown of all your skills by 1 second. That's for each enemy. This is going to synergize really well with popping your Soul Harvest. When you pop it and enemies die, you basically get to reset all your cooldowns and you can head off and instantly kill more enemies. Now, it's because of Grave Injustice that we'll want to have some items with pickup radius on them. It's not the most important thing, but wherever you can get it, get it. The base radius is 20 yards, and for the most part, you're just dealing damage to enemies within 20 yards of you. But particularly if you're playing in a party and things might be dying by your friend's hands a little bit further away, that's where Grave Injustice really starts to kick in. Alright, let's take a closer look now at the items and what you ideally want on every piece of gear. For your shoulders, you want intelligence, vitality, haunt damage, then either area damage or cooldown reduction. With this build, we're going to be spamming Haunt in order to reduce the cooldown on Soul Harvest, but if you don't want to have to rely on that as much, you could get some cooldown on your gear. For your helm, intelligence, vitality, crit chance, and you'll want a diamond for that cooldown. For your amulet, poison damage, crit, or whatever element you go with. For your chest piece, intelligence, vitality, haunt damage. For your gloves, intelligence, crit, area damage, or cooldown. Bracers, elemental damage, intelligence, vitality, crit chance. For your belt, intelligence, vitality, life, armor. For your pants, intelligence, vitality, armor. As well, try to get a secondary resistance wherever you can. For your boots, intelligence, vitality, armor, then either move speed or all resist, depending on what you get on your secondaries. It's a little bit negotiable there. For your compass rose, intelligence, crit, and then either area damage or cooldown. For your other ring, whether you are cubing or equipping your convention or your ring of emptiness, doesn't matter. Go with whichever is better and just toss into your cube the one that rolls worse. In general, you'll likely have a better convention on you, but regardless, the stats you'll want are crit, then either area damage or cooldown. Again though, if you are going with cooldown isn't super important for this build, so definitely don't overinvest in cooldown. For your weapon, percent damage, intelligence, area damage. And for your offhand, intelligence, crit chance, area damage, haunt damage. And that wraps up this guide. This was recorded on the test server, but I don't really expect this build to change. It hasn't changed at all since the last time this build was viable. I'm not expecting to see any changes. Even if we see some numbers tweaked, it won't change the overall build that you'll go with. That said, I'll have an updated link to the D3 planner in the description below. So for all the most up-to-date best in slot, you can check that, all the best skills, all the best gear. And if there somehow is some crazy developments and this build changes significantly enough, I'll have an updated video as we get closer to the start of the season. That wraps up this video. Thanks for watching. Special thanks to my Twitch and Patreon supporters for making these videos possible. If you enjoyed this video, please share it, check out these other videos, and subscribe to join Riker's Raiders for more Diablo content.